How many of you noticed that our speaker changed? Good. Well, we went from a great speaker to another great speaker, so it's all going to be good. In fact, Dr. Grant, Bill Grant, he is on our board of directors and has been with us, is it all 20 years you've been with Smart Life, pretty much? 2000, so 11 years. He studied the roles of nutrition, ultraviolet radiation exposure, and vitamin D in the risk of disease, starting in 1996 when he was working as an atmospheric scientist at the NASA Langley Research Center in Virginia. He does research using the ecological study approach, in which health outcomes for populations are averaged either for geographical units, such as states or countries, or by temporal variations, which are compared statistically with risk-modifying factors such as UVB doses or dietary factors. I'm going to cut this short and let Bill take over. But his lecture is on UV exposure, vitamin D, and nutrition for optimal health. Let me start this for you, Bill.
Hello, hello. There we go. Okay, it's a pleasure to be back here. I haven't been here for years because my ride from San Francisco left me. So I've watched it on my computer sometimes and look at the videos afterwards. But I see a few faces I remember from 6, 7 years ago when I was coming. So I retired in 2004 to work full-time on health studies. My background is in physics and atmospheric studies. And what I've done is I've worked with data rather than working with people. But by looking at sort of a broad overview of the data on health outcomes, where based on where people live or the season, I can then get a lot of insight into what might be causing the problems. And I might point out that we have a health system that would rather treat people than prevent them from getting sick in the first place. So that leaves a lot of room for trying to find out what causes diseases that they want to treat, so I can try to get people to not get those. Yeah, I receive funding from Biotech Pharmacal. They make vitamin and mineral supplements. The Vitamin D Society in Canada and the Vitamin D Council in San Luis Obispo, California. In the past, I've also received funding from the UV Foundation and the Sunlight Research Forum for doing work that supported the role of UV in health and gave some support to the health benefits of indoor tanning. I have a pretty ambitious schedule this evening, and I'm going to leave out a number of these slides because in interest of time, but we're going to discuss vitamin D physiology, the types of studies used to figure out what vitamin D does, the classical effect of vitamin D, which is to control calcium absorption and metabolism, then get into the role of vitamin D in pregnancy, the role of vitamin D in other health conditions and diseases, sources of vitamin D, recommendations, and web resources regarding vitamin D. Now, vitamin D research is a really hot topic in the past 10 or 15 years. It was a sleepy topic until mid-90s, late 90s, early 2000s, because they thought it was just had the classical role, which was affecting calcium. But when people started to find effects on cancer and infectious diseases and autoimmune diseases, other people got involved in the research. And so by 2015, there are probably about 4,000 papers published last year, and the rate continues to increase. Skip ahead. The vitamin D is produced by the shortwave radiation. The very shortest wave that comes through the atmosphere. It's the UVB, which is from about 290 to 315 nanometers. The visible radiation is about 400 to 700 nanometers. And then the bulk of the UV is what's called UVA. And that's from 320 to 400 nanometers. So the UVB hits a type of cholesterol in the skin and makes a provitamin D. And after that, there's a thermal process which converts it to vitamin D, the same type of vitamin D that you take in a supplement. That then goes to the, I guess we'll go ahead here. Well, that goes to, I'll talk to that about that later. So the importance of vitamin D is underscored by the fact that skin pigmentation varies around the world based on where people have lived for hundreds to thousands of years. So this is a map of human skin pigmentation from Jablonski and Chaplin. The darker areas on this map are where people have the darkest skin because they live pretty much on exposed plains, the plains of Africa or the plains of Australia. So they can spend all day in the sun without getting sunburn, but there's enough UVB there that they can make the vitamin D they need. And as people migrated out of the tropics to higher latitudes, those who had fairer skin were favored. Their bones wouldn't malform, so they could have normal pregnancies without compressed pelvises. They wouldn't get infectious diseases, and they had other benefits from having the lighter skin. Let's see. Here's the schematic of the role of vitamin D in metabolism. So the sunlight hits the skin, produces the vitamin D in the skin, it goes to the liver, where it picks up a hydroxyl radical. So when you go to the doctor's office and want to have your vitamin D levels measured, they're measuring the 25 hydroxy vitamin D, which is a circulating form of vitamin D that's processed by the liver. The vitamin D you take doesn't last very long in the body, but it's mainly the circulating form. But then the circulating form is not the active form. The active form is formed in the kidneys, where it receives a second hydroxyl group, and that's called 1,25 dihydroxy vitamin D. The concentration of that is about 1/1,000th that of the circulating 25 hydroxy vitamin D, and that, along with the there's another compound called parathyroid hormone or PTH, and there's a balance between the PTH and the hormonal version of vitamin D that regulate the calcium levels in the blood. So if you have too little vitamin D, the PTH wants to take the vitamin D, the calcium, out of the bones. If you have enough vitamin D, enough 125, then you'll take the calcium in from the intestines, from the food. Now, the way that vitamin D acts is primarily through effects on the genes. So most cells have vitamin D receptors coupled to the chromosomes. And when the hormonal version of vitamin D hits the vitamin D receptor, it can essentially turn on or control the expression of genes, turning some on, turning some off. A lot of genes are waiting to be signaled by vitamin D. Now, there are a number of ways of trying to figure out what vitamin D does. It's a natural compound, so you can do natural experiments. Some of these are what we call observational studies, where you look at people and how much vitamin D they have and what kind of health they have. You can either measure them at the time they get sick, like with cancer, find out how much vitamin D they had at that time, and measure a lot of people and try to correlate it. You can do cross-sectional studies where you just go and survey an entire country, a few thousand people, and then correlate the vitamin D levels with their state of health. You can do laboratory studies looking at cells or with animals to find out the mechanisms. You want to try to really show that it's vitamin D and not sunshine or something that's doing the effect. You might want to do what are called randomized controlled trials, like they do for pharmaceutical drugs. And then you can do the type of study I like, which is called ecological studies, which is where you define populations either geographically, like by state or by country, or you look at populations as a function of time. Is some disease more common in summer or winter, and can you relate that to vitamin D? So let's skip over these slides. I might say that there are a number of major vitamin D randomized controlled trials underway in the United States, Canada, New Zealand, India, Finland. Most are giving about 2,000 IU per day of vitamin D. Unfortunately, not all these studies have measured the amount of vitamin D levels in the blood at the time people were enrolled in the study. And also, many of these people are healthy people, active, out in the sun, and so on. So it's not really clear to me how much we're going to learn from these trials, but the medical community is waiting for the results in the next 2 to 3 years. And if they don't find anything, it's going to set back the research in vitamin D for another decade, I suppose. So the first ecological study used to identify the effect of sunlight on cancer was done by the brothers Cedric and Frank Garland they were published in 1980. And I'll show some of their data a little bit later. Such studies are considered hypothesis generating, but in my opinion, they're much more important than that. So the first effect of known effect of vitamin D was to affect calcium absorption and metabolism and reduce the risk of such things as rickets. And these African children with their bowed legs and knocked knees and so on, they're classical cases of rickets. Adults can have osteomalacia, which is weakening of the bones caused by deficiency of vitamin D, and they can have bowed legs like this. There's a lot of talk about the role of vitamin D in preventing falls and fractures. Many women are told after you reach menopause, start taking vitamin D so you won't fall and break your hip or your legs or something. So there are two mechanisms involved. One is that the calcium and vitamin D can help make stronger bones, although it's not clear that you make the strong bones then. You usually make the strong bones when you're young, and you sort of keep as much of that along within your body as you can as you get older. But you also have better neuromuscular control, so you're less likely to fall, which is maybe the more important reason to take vitamin D later in life. Now, this is just a schematic showing that there are many causes of vitamin D deficiency. One is wearing sunscreen, which I don't really recommend for most people, unless you're in danger of getting a sunburn. Unfortunately, most women's cosmetics have vitamin D sunscreens built in, so women probably get less vitamin D than men. There are a number of medications that reduce vitamin D levels. The glucocorticoids, corticoids, for example, and some other medications will reduce vitamin D levels. There's also malabsorption, some intestinal problems like Crohn's disease and celiac disease. There can be organ problems such as renal failure. Obese people have much lower levels of vitamin D than thin people because it's a matter of volumetric dilution, just a larger reservoir to fill. And we'll get into the consequences as we go through this talk. Now, I think one of the most important aspects of vitamin D is taking vitamin D during pregnancy. And unfortunately, the recommendations, recommended by the medical system, I think it's only 600 or 800 IU per day for pregnant women. But that's very, 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 very much insufficient. It turns out that vitamin D levels during pregnancy can set the stage for the entire life. They can set whether the child may get rickets, respiratory infections, may come out preterm, have low birth rate, whether they develop type 1 diabetes early in life. It can also affect the cognitive function and word ability at age 5 and 10. It can even lead to problems later in life, cardiovascular disease, et cetera. So this is an area where it's important that pregnant women know that they really should be taking lots of vitamin D. There are a number of adverse outcomes to mother, such as increased risk of primary C-section, gestational diabetes, influenza-like illness during pregnancy, preeclampsia, diabetes, dental caries, and periodontal disease. Here's an example of an observational study on preeclampsia and vitamin D levels. So at the left side, with where the zero is where the vitamin D levels are lowest, and the risk of preeclampsia is highest. As you go out, as levels build up, And these are nanomoles per liter. You have to divide by 2.5 to get nanograms per milliliter, which is what we use in the United States. So 100 nanomoles per liter here is 40 nanograms. And you see there's still probably benefits above that. Primary C-section, again, this is nanomoles per liter. So if a woman has around 10 or 15 nanograms per milliliter, she's much more likely to require primary C-section than if she has 40 or 50 nanograms per milliliter. Of course, nowadays, maybe two-thirds of C-sections are elective by the doctor or the patient. The problem with a C-section is, one problem is that when the newborn goes through the birth canal, they pick up a lot of bacteria, maybe viruses, that help with digestion and immune function. And if they just are pulled from the uterus with C-section, they don't get that benefit. So that puts them at a disadvantage in many respects. The many problems with it, I've already mentioned these. Now, there was a very good trial involving pregnant women done in South Carolina by Bruce Hollis and Carol Wagner. And at the time, the NIH has to approve all intervention studies such as this. At the time, there was a concern by NIH, and this is about 5 or 6 years ago, that giving pregnant women more than, say, a 500 or 1,000 international units of vitamin D per day might be hazardous. So Bruce had to spend 6 months going through the literature and documenting the fact that there were no adverse effects, no adverse effects from taking high doses of vitamin D. And he was able to conduct an experiment with up to 4,000 IU per day until starting the 12th week of gestation through delivery. And the goal was to maintain concentrations of 32 nanograms per milliliter or higher involving both black and white women. And what he found was that it took getting up to about 40 nanograms per milliliter before the hormonal version of vitamin D stabilized. Now, as I said before, the hormonal version affects gene expression. And there's no time that gene expression is more important than during fetal development. The genes are turned on and turned off during development, and you've got to have the right ones turning on and turning off. And so this is a very, very important finding. You see, this is there's a line going through the data there, and it doesn't stabilize to about 40 nanograms, 100 nanomoles per liter. Below that is suboptimal, and the baby just isn't getting the proper cues on how to develop. He found absolutely no adverse effects, no hypercalcemia, no hypercalciuria, no adverse effects. So this is, if you know anybody, you have children or friends or somebody thinking about getting pregnant, vitamin D can help with getting pregnant, and also helps during the entire pregnancy process, and also during breastfeeding. If a woman takes 4,000 IU per day, she then takes it daily, she still has about 400 IU of vitamin D per day in the breast milk, which is what the infant needs. The infant cannot use the processed vitamin D. The infant really needs to have the native vitamin D. This is just a schematic from Grassroots Health showing that there are a lot of benefits for getting up to and above 40 nanograms per milliliter for both the mother and the infant. Autism, John Cannell wrote a paper in 2008 hypothesizing that the risk of vitamin D is due in part to low vitamin D. He pointed out that the rates of autism are much higher for children born to Somali women, who are of course dark, living in Sweden, than those born to native women, so Swedish women, so they have much lower vitamin D levels. Autism rates are much higher in the U.S. where solar UVB doses are lower, such as where it's cloudy or rainy, and vitamin D reduces inflammation, and you can imagine that neuron inflammation in the brain could be associated with risk of autism. We published a study together 3 years ago, which we showed that for whites, those living where it was had less solar UVB in October had higher rates of autism prevalence than those living where it was sunniest. Vitamin D also fights many infectious diseases, both viral and bacterial. Among bacterial diseases are dental caries, pneumonia, sepsis, and tuberculosis. Among the viral infections are influenza and likely mononucleosis, Hodgkin's lymphoma, which is caused by Epstein-Barr virus, and multiple sclerosis. So the first study demonstrating that vitamin D reduced risk of dental caries was conducted in Sheffield, England in 1928 by Mae Mellenby. She was supplementing boys with vitamin D and not others. Those who were supplemented developed fewer caries than those who were not supplemented. The assumed mechanism, of course, in that day was that it improved calcium metabolism. However, being a good scientist, she noted that the bacteria in the dental caries were dead. Of course, she had no idea why that happened. In the 30s, 40s, and 50s, there were a number of vitamin D supplementation studies involving children, and I found that reduced the risk of dental caries by about 50%. What I showed in a paper in 2011 was that if I plotted, this is actually dental health rank of veterans in, I think, both World War I and World War II, that those coming from the sunny states with the highest above 7 units of UVB in the summer had almost the same dental rank. But as you went lower in dental rank, lower in UVB, the dental rank got much worse. In fact, even in 1865, a study was published about the number of teeth of the veterans in the Civil War in the Union side. Those coming from the northern states, like Maine and Vermont, had fewer teeth than those from, say, Kentucky. Of course, again, they didn't know anything about UVB, vitamin D, et cetera, but the documentation was there, just waiting for an interpretation later in life.
Later history.
I was alive back then, I just. In 1981, Hope Simpson published a paper looking at the seasonality of influenza. As you can see here, it peaks around January in the Northern Hemisphere and around July in the Southern Hemisphere. And in the equator, there's not much seasonality, except for the rainy. When you have a rainy season, you have less UVB, and so you have you can have a rainy season affected. Well, John Cannell suggested, he was working as a psychiatrist at a Tascadero hospital for the criminally insane, and he was giving his patients 5,000 IU per day. And when the influenza epidemic came through that year, his patients were largely unaffected. So he got to thinking that maybe vitamin D reduced the risk of influenza. And so he published a paper in 2006 where he hypothesized that vitamin D reduced the risk of influenza. And it's gotten a lot of people interested. And in fact, it turns out that a study involving black postmenopausal women in New York was done to look at the effects on bones, but they happened to have data on self-reported flu and cold symptoms. And they found that those taking 2,000 IU per day had very few bouts. Those taking 800 had a few, moderate amount. Those taking a placebo had many. And so this is the first experimental verification that vitamin D could actually reduce the risk of influenza. Another trial in Japan involving school children showed that it did reduce the risk of type A influenza, but not type B. Now, it turns out that there's another factor. Just when it's cold, that increases the risk for influenza because the viruses for influenza live better when it's low humidity and cold temperatures. So it's more rapidly transmitted in winter than in summer. And it turns out that the cold body is more susceptible to infection. In fact, I found that if I would jog at temperature below 60 degrees, I get bronchitis, which would last 2 weeks no matter how much vitamin C and vitamin D I took. I don't jog at that temperature anymore. But I think this shows that even if there is a predisposing factor of cold temperature, that vitamin D still plays an important role in reducing the risk. And it turns out it also helps, if you get influenza, it will help you prevent you from dying from influenza. The way we figured, I could figure that out was looking at the results of the pandemic influenza in 1918-1919 in the United States. Back then, the public health department went around to about 12 or so communities, did door-to-door surveys, asking everybody, did anybody in this household develop influenza? And if so, did they die? And so they developed what was called a case fatality study. And what they found was that in the South and the West, where there's more UVB and vitamin D production, both in summer and winter, there were fewer case fatalities than in the northern areas where there's less UVB vitamin D. So it turns out that the what vitamin D is doing is, one way is it inducing this cathelicidin and defensins, which have antibiotic and anti-endotoxin properties. And the other is by inducing inflammation by reducing production of pro-inflammatory cytokines. Cytokines are proteins that act as chemical messengers between cells. And when you get influenza, you can get what's called a cytokine storm, which causes inflammation, which causes rupturing of some of the membranes, which allows the bacteria that are there to start to develop into pneumonia. So anyway, that's how that works. So in the winter, take your vitamin D. If you develop influenza, take vitamin D. And if you're planning to go stay in a hospital,
you change that slide too fast.
Okay, in winter, take vitamin D. If you develop influenza, take vitamin D. And then I talked about this study I talked about in the pandemic influenza epidemic from 1918-19. But I'm going to sort of extend this and say that if you are planning a stay in the hospital, whereas you're aware there are a lot of antibiotic-resistant bacteria wandering around now, vitamin D will help reduce your risk of contracting those bacteria, as well as developing sepsis or blood infections, and will help improve wound healing. There are a number of autoimmune diseases. Autoimmune disease is an illness that occurs when the body tissues are attacked by its own immune system. The immune system is a complex organization within the body that is designed to normally to seek and destroy invaders of the body, including infectious agents. People with autoimmune diseases frequently have unusual antibodies circulating in their blood that target their own body tissues. So the risk factors for autoimmune diseases include infections such as Epstein-Barr virus for multiple sclerosis, and low UVB exposure and vitamin D levels leading to pro-inflammatory cytokines. There are a number of autoimmune diseases. The most well-known one, I suppose, is multiple sclerosis. There's also rheumatoid arthritis, type 1 diabetes, et cetera. Now here's an example of an ecological study of multiple sclerosis in France. So the color coding on the map of France goes from the blue is, the light blue is around 6.5 units of UVB in the summer, I believe, and the red is this is the multiple, so the, okay, 10 is the highest UVB down in the south near the beaches. The light blue is around 6.5 in the north. So as you go north in France, you get less and less UVB. The numbers in that represent the, I think that's the multiple sclerosis rate by region. And then it's plotted on the other side, and it turns out that I think it's that women have a much higher rate of multiple sclerosis than men do. So the red dots are for the women, the squares are for the men. But there is a definite relationship between the annual UVB and the amount of multiple sclerosis. Now, that was a sort of an ecological study. There's also a mouse model study that showed that UV may have more beneficial effects in fighting multiple sclerosis than does taking vitamin D. Although people who take vitamin D also get benefits. Interesting study in rheumatoid arthritis involving the nurse's health study. It turns out for the older women, women living in the regions of the country that had the higher UVB doses had a 21% lower risk of developing rheumatoid arthritis than those living in the lower UVB regions. In other words, if they live in the north, they had a higher risk than in the south. But it turns out for the younger women, there was not much of a difference, only about 10%, which wasn't considered statistically significant. The authors note that younger women were more likely to wear sunblock than older women. Type 1 diabetes, let's skip over. Okay, cardiovascular disease.
I'm not following that. If the younger women are wearing sunblock, then they would have, they should have more of a problem because they don't.
Exactly. Well, but there's no difference between whether they lived in a sunny area or a shady area. So they lost the advantage of living in the sun area because they wore sunblock.
I see.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, so we have cardiovascular disease, we have congestive heart failure, stroke, coronary heart disease, and peripheral arterial disease. They may involve clogging the arteries, leakage of blood into the brain, or poor muscle function of the heart. Clogged arteries are generally caused by one of two things, either animal fat, saturated fat. Finland had a doctor who figured out that they had too much saturated animal fat in their diet. He made it an effort to change that and brought the rates way down. Added sugars can also clog the arteries through buildup of triglycerides. I actually published a study in 1998 in which I did a multi-country ecological study and found that for men, countries that had higher animal fats had more men with clogged arteries, but for women, it was countries with more added sugars or sweeteners in the diet. Well, I went and had a National Press Club conference, and not only did somebody from the Sugar Association come up from Florida, but also somebody from the American Heart Association issued a press release saying this is nonsense. Well, it turns out in 1998, the American Heart Association was selling a seal of approval for low-fat food, never mind if sugar replaced the fat to keep the calorie level up and the taste up. And so they didn't like me getting in their pocketbook, and so they quashed the science. 5 years ago, with Robert Lustig's help from UCSF, I think he's spoken here before, they finally agreed that, yes, sugar does clog the arteries. But when it, you know, affected their pocketbook, they weren't going to admit it. So unfortunately, I don't think vitamin D does reduce the clogging of the arteries. There are a recent paper suggests that for your dietary factors, you want to have increased fruits, non-starchy vegetables, nuts, legumes, fish, vegetables, oils like olive oil, yogurt, minimally processed whole grains, and fewer red meats, processed meats, and foods rich in refined grain, starch, added sugars, salt, and trans fat. They put a number of other factors, including vitamin D and coffee and so on, as not well known yet. One thing that is quite well known is that cardiovascular disease is much more common in winter than in summer. This has been observed both in warm countries, such as Kuwait and Australia, and cold countries, such as Northern Europe. Of course, you have cold temperature, which is a risk factor that can raise blood pressure. You also have low vitamin D. So how does vitamin D protect against cardiovascular disease? One, it helps maintain the integrity of the surface layer of the organs. That's called endothelial function. Reduces inflammation, reduces risk of insulin resistance, reduces risk of hypertension, perhaps, and reduces the risk of calcification. If your arteries calcify, then that can help raise blood pressure, which is a risk factor for cardiovascular disease. Vitamin D also appears to reduce the risk of many diseases that may end up in death from cardiovascular disease, such as chronic kidney disease, metabolic syndrome, diabetes mellitus type 2, influenza, pneumonia, et cetera. Now here is what's called a meta-analysis of observational studies looking at levels of vitamin D and the relative risk of developing vitamin D in observational prospective studies. In other words, they enroll people, measure the vitamin D levels, and follow them for 1, 5, 10 years. And so you see this is, again, in nanomoles per liter, but those at the bottom have about 8 nanograms per milliliter, and they have over twice the risk of people who have above 30 nanograms per milliliter. This has been observed in all seasons in many studies, so I don't think it's just related to the seasonal variation of vitamin D. However, there have been no clinical trials that have demonstrated that giving vitamin D to people reduces the risk of cardiovascular disease. So it's a bit of a mystery there. Diabetes mellitus type 2 has that's can be a result of a diet that leads to too much insulin production, followed by developing insulin resistance. And it turns out both dietary sugars and dietary fats are linked to risk of diabetes type 2. Eating meat is a risk factor for type 2, as is eating candy. Turns out vitamin D appears to reduce the risk of type 2 diabetes through mechanisms related to insulin production and insulin resistance. And again, a meta-analysis shows that people with lower vitamin D levels have a lower risk of developing type 2 diabetes. Alzheimer's disease, that's actually the first disease I studied back in 1996-97. As a type of dementia characterized by plaques and tangles in the brain. In Europe and in Northern Europe, United States, about 5% of people over the age of 65 years have Alzheimer's disease. The rate doubles every year, every 5 years. There are genetic contributions to the risk of Alzheimer's, but environmental causes are much more important. And diet is a very strong risk factor. The most recent way to demonstrate this is that Japan used to have very, very low rates of Alzheimer's disease. They had less than 1%, about 1% from below before 1985. Back in 1960, their diet had only 15% of the energy from animal products, and that was primarily from seafood, which is a source of omega-3 fatty acids and vitamin D. Now they're up to about 7%, and it happened very, very rapidly. It happened about, there was a lag of about 20 to 25 years between the dietary change. As they added more meat, more sugar, more alcohol, more smoking, there's about a 20 to 25 year lag as that sort of built up. Also, breast cancer, colon cancer, prostate cancer rates went up at about the same rate. So, in fact, the way I got involved in this study was back in 1996. It was pointed out that Japanese Americans in Hawaii had 2.5 times the prevalence of Alzheimer's in native Japanese. And so I knew it had to be other than genetics, then I figured it had to be the American diet. An important dietary risk factor appears to be meat, especially when cooked at high temperatures, such as frying or roasting. One thing that does is increases the concentration of glucose linked to the proteins. This is called advanced glycation end products. It makes meat taste good, which is why in the South they love their barbecue, they love their fried food, their fried fish. But it seems that's also where strokes are most common, and cardiovascular disease is most common, and lung cancer is most common, and Alzheimer's is most common. So it's better to, if you're going to eat meat, to boil it, or well, you can't eat it raw because of risk of bacterial contamination. My latest finding, I'm writing a manuscript on this. I took 10 countries from Nigeria and India up through Japan, Korea, and United States, and I tried to ask whether meat consumption explained the variation of Alzheimer's in these countries, and did up until a point, except Japan and Korea had high rates of Alzheimer's, but only a moderate amount of meat in the diet. So then I added eggs and fish, and they have a lot of fish in the Japanese and Korean diet. And that then brought the all the countries into a straight line with an R of 0.97. I explained 94% of the variance along this curve. So it looks as if, in fact, it was pointed out in 1993 that the Adventists, who are primarily vegetarians, they'll eat maybe some milk, maybe some eggs, they had low rates of dementia compared with omnivores, most Americans. But it turns out the few of them that ate meat had 2.5 times as much Alzheimer's as those who didn't eat the meat. So even back in the 90s, it was known. But of course, with our corporate health political system, the word is not going to get out very far and very fast that eating meat may be a cause for Alzheimer's disease. And fish is sort of a double-edged sword. If you eat a little bit of fish, you can get the omega-3 fatty acids. But if you eat too much fish, you start getting all the adverse effects of you point out, this acidic forming. It causes free radicals. And you've lost any, then you're just getting the protein that's probably involved with some of the risk for Alzheimer's. Well, vitamin D does play somewhat of a role, it appears. People who had below 20 nanograms per milliliter of vitamin D in their blood had a reduced risk of Alzheimer's. Again, these are observational studies, but there seem to be mechanisms that would explain it. For Parkinson's disease, there's both a study showing that vitamin D levels in the blood affected the risk. There are also ecological studies showing people who live where it's sunnier have a lower risk of Parkinson's disease. Now, let's turn to cancer, which is what I've actually spent much of my time on. Of course, the most important risk factor for cancer includes smoking, a little bit from alcohol consumption, but a large fraction of risk of cancer comes from eating meat and other animal products, maybe not milk, and then some carcinogens such as pesticides. There was an important study done in 1975 that looked at the incidence and mortality rates for cancers in many countries and found that most of these were highly correlated with meat consumption, and diet and animal protein and things like that. I repeated that study more recently and got more or less the same thing, that the countries that had more animal products in the diet had, like Northern Europe, had much more risk of cancer than, say, tropical countries where they don't eat much meat. They're more plant-based, more grain-based and the like. So one mechanism for animal products is that they produce what's called insulin-like growth factor, IGFI. It makes the body grow. That'll lead to earlier menarche, earlier sexual maturity, and greater adult height. Adult height has been linked to cancer. Taller people are more prone to get cancer and many other chronic diseases. And having more fat and protein consumption early in life appears to be what causes people to grow taller. I mean, you stop growing after 21 or 22. So if you're tall, you had a protein, fat-rich diet when you're young. Vitamin D has several mechanisms for reducing the risk of developing cancer and increasing survival after it starts. One mechanism is regulation of cells causing the bad cells to die, letting good cells proliferate. Another is it reduces inflammation, and inflammation is considered an important risk factor for cancer. For example, the esophageal cancer is often caused by irritating the lining of the esophagus and the stomach with, say, like with alcohol or with hot tea or hot coffee. Once cancer starts, vitamin D reduces the growth of blood vessels around the tumors. The tumors have to, when they get large, they have to have blood vessels bringing in the nutrients. And this is also reduces metastasis to the other organs. Some of the strongest evidence that UVB and vitamin D reduce the risk of cancer comes from ecological studies. And as, the first was reported by the brothers Cedric and Frank Garland, who saw a picture of the cancer mortality rates by state in 1974 when they were beginning graduate students at Johns Hopkins. It took them 6 years to get their study published in a British journal. They couldn't get it published in a United States journal. The red shows the very high rates of colon cancer in the Northeast. The blue rates show the low risk of colon cancer in the Southwest. I must point out that in those days, they only had 5 colors instead of 10 colors, and so it was harder to see the variations. And so the only cancer they found could say that that's a vitamin D sensitive, a UVB sensitive cancer, was colon cancer. And they just said, well, we have a hypothesis that since vitamin D production is the most important physiological effect of vitamin D, it's probably vitamin D that's fighting cancer. They then, in the next few years, showed that taking vitamin D, people took more vitamin D, had a reduced risk of colon cancer, and people had higher vitamin D levels in the blood, had lower risk of developing colon cancer. But still, you know, big pharma and NIH and CDC just didn't want to deal with it and recognize it because they want to treat disease, not prevent it. Well, the Garlands went on and looked at breast cancer. Here's a map that has a similar pattern. All you see in California and Nevada and Washington, we have more red than we had for colon cancer. What's interesting is along the coast of California, there's more pink and red than there is in the interior of California. Well, what's happening there is that there's more fog and clouds, so you have less sun exposure. Like in San Francisco, it's foggy all summer, so that probably explains part of the reason that's red up in San Francisco. Here's for bladder cancer. Again, you have the red in the Northeast, but also in Louisiana in Cancer Alley. From all the chemical companies down there, you have a lot of chemicals getting in the water and in the food, and so there's a lot of bladder cancer there. Again, along the coast of California, Oregon, and Washington, you have, yes?
It looks like an urban effect to me, that you've got the major urban centers being hot spots, and I'm wondering about air pollution as an aggravating factor.
Well, okay, in my more complex analysis, let's say I first published a study in 2002 adding... Okay, the question was, is this an urban effect rather than an air pollution effect rather than a UVB effect? So, I was going to say that in 2002, I published a paper in the journal Cancer saying that in addition to five cancers that were known to be UVB sensitive at that time, looking at the maps, there are another 10 types of cancer. So this is duly published, and I got good press from this. But then the people started asking, well, what about the other factors? What about smoking and... urban residents and poverty and alcohol. So I put all these factors in the regression model, redid the analysis, and I shopped it to 9 different journals. At one journal I was told, well, you're not really trained in this field. Get a real epidemiologist on your team. Get a real statistician on your team, little kid, and we'll consider publishing it. Well, I got Cedric Garland as a co-author, and we got it published eventually in a Greek journal as a result of going to a conference in Germany, because again, the American journals that deal with medicine didn't want to touch this. Later, I did a paper on air pollution. And what I did there was I used the index for acid rain for 1985, because acid rain is mainly from coal-fired power plants. It's from diesel cars, wood burning, and coal-fired power plants. And it is highest in the Northeast, but it has some different variation from the UVB. In fact, here's UVB. UVB is highest in the Southwest, lowest in the Northeast, but it has a similar pattern to what you've seen here.
Why is Nevada so high?
Okay, it turns out in the East Coast, from the Rocky Mountains to the east, you have pretty much a straight latitudinal gradient, sort of horizontal lines. But in the west, you have the air mass coming across, wants to cross the Rocky Mountains, so it sort of raises the tropopause height, makes the stratospheric ozone layer thinner, so we have less shield of the UVB from the ozone. But you also have, like in Nevada and other states in the west, a higher surface elevation, so it's less blockage of the UVB by atmospheric scattering. So that's why you have this asymmetry. But anyway, back to the air pollution study. It turns out that all the cancers that are linked to smoking are also linked to coal fire pollution. It turns out that the black particles that come out of coal fire and diesel and wood burning, this is activated charcoal, which will adsorb a compound called PAH, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbon. And that's just like in the tobacco smoke. It gets in the lungs, it lodges there, and then the PAH is released into the blood where it can go to the various organs and cause cancer. So I figured that it caused 3 to 5% of the cancers in the United States from the coal-fired power plants. But I could separate it from the UVB effect.
If you have questions, please raise your hand so we can get it on the recording. Thank you.
I had a similar question going back about 3 slides. Just, I think the one just beyond, back from that. And was there one right? Okay, go forward then. So in this case, Clearly, you have areas that are on the same latitude that don't in any way have similar densities, either in population or in environmental contaminants, that are not having the same kind of problems at all. And to me, it seems like an odd conclusion to say that the factor is the amount of light that makes a difference. If that were the case, then in fact, all that northwest region should be red, as I see it.
Well, as I pointed out, this was the first study that Cedric did, the first study I did. If you look at a more complex analysis, which I published in 2006 and 2011 and so on, when you put the other factors in, you start adjusting for the amount of alcohol consumed, like in Nevada. You start accounting for the Hispanic heritage in the Southwest. You account for the urban density. You account for poverty levels. Unfortunately, what we don't have is good information on dietary factors, which
exactly.
Is also.
Exactly. And it's kind of a known fact that it's very difficult to get really good food in the East Coast and the Northeast Coast. So anyway, thank you.
Well, the ecological studies are considered hypothesis generating. There have been two randomized controlled trials that did show that taking vitamin D did reduce the risk of developing cancer. We have a lot of observational studies, if we get beyond these. Here's an occupational study in the Nordic countries. So we had a lot of data on cancer incidence rates by occupation. It turns out that waiters had the highest rate of all cancer incidents, 1.48 times the normal, whereas your tobacco workers, beverage workers had higher rates. Teachers had a little bit lower rates. Gardeners, forestry workers, and farmers who work out of doors had the lowest rates. So I developed a what's called a UVB index, which was trying to get an index of personal UV exposure from being on the job. So I knew that lip cancer was caused by UV exposure, but also by smoking. So I said, well, let's just take lip cancer minus lung cancer, and that's the index. And lo and behold, it lined up very well with these cancers. Turns out that these people who worked out of doors, they had lower risk of melanoma and a somewhat lower risk of non-melanoma skin cancer. Because the body, if you go out every day in the sun, the body has mechanisms to protect against melanoma. If you wear sunscreen, you take away the body's innate ability to fight melanoma. So here's one. For women, they wear lipstick, so I couldn't use their lip cancer rates to determine this. So I'd use the same rate for men that I use for women. But anyway, they still showed a similar effect. Bladder cancer was similar. So anyway, if you want to show an effect is real, you want to try to show it in different populations using different approaches. And this was a different approach that had a similar result to with the same cancers as we found in the ecological studies in the United States. Now here's another one for breast cancer. This is a combination of 11 case control studies. In other words, when women came in with breast cancer, the vitamin D level in the blood was measured, and I then plotted this. This is from six different countries, and this is in nanomoles per liter, so divide by 2.5. So above 40 nanograms, there wasn't much change, but if you get down to around 10 nanomoles or around 4 or 5 nanograms, you have three times what you would have at 30 nanomoles, and about maybe 10 times what you'd have at 140 nanomoles. So the average population in the United States, the average white population is around 62 on this graph. The average black population is around 40, 45. And the blacks have higher rates of cancer and poorer survival rates, which I think in large part is due to just the fact that they have lower vitamin D levels. Now, there are 17 types of cancer that I've come up with that seem to be vitamin D sensitive. So your gastrointestinal, your urinary, your female cancers, your blood cancers, and melanoma. There's almost all the cancers, except maybe cervical cancer. Turns out UV is a risk factor because it reduces the immune system response to HPV virus. Now, here's another study from Norway showing that people diagnosed with cancer have much better survival rates if they have higher vitamin D levels at the start. This is going from the ones that had the longest survival had above 30 to 35 nanograms per milliliter. Those with the lowest survival had around 15 or so nanograms per milliliter. This is over a 9-year period. So I think it's pretty convincing that having higher vitamin D levels at when you're diagnosed with cancer, you're going to survive. And I think it also then implies that if you get cancer, you want to raise your vitamin D levels and maybe have that be one of your primary ways of dealing with cancer. There are also effects on athletic performance. Again, John Cannell pointed this out, pointing out that there are a number of things that correlate with being in the sun and having better athletic performance. He was pointing out that he thinks that the Russians and the East Germans used to use either UV lamps or high-dose vitamin D for their athletes to win a lot of the Olympics. He also pointed out in the 1968 Olympics that were held in Mexico City, people arrived early to get used to the altitude, but were also out exercising in the sun and built their vitamin D levels up and got a lot of world records that year. This is probably not of interest. I'll skip this. Okay, this is a study by Cedric Garland and company looking at all-cause mortality rate as a function of vitamin D levels. This is a taking about 32 studies, observational studies where people enrolled, their vitamin D was level measured, level was measured, and they were followed and to see who died. And what it came out to be was that if they had above 36 nanograms per milliliter, there was no change in the mortality rate. But below that, there was, if they had below 10 nanograms, they had a factor 1.9 factor 1.9 higher rate of dying than if they had a risk of dying soon than if they had the higher rate, higher level. So this is, again, observational study. There are randomized controlled trials that show that taking vitamin D3 has had some effect on all-cause mortality rate. Turns out, however, that taking vitamin D2 actually increased mortality rate. And I'll get into D2 and D3 in a couple minutes. Another thing we find is that there's a large seasonality of deaths, highest in winter, lowest in summer. In Denmark, there's a 14% higher rate in winter than in summer. Recently there's an article in the Wall Street Journal reproducing data from 2010 by David Phillips from UC San Diego. He graphed the deaths per day over a 15-year period. And what he was a sociologist. What he was excited about was there were peaks around Christmas and New Year's, which he's called a holiday effect. People over-imbibing, getting excited, emergency rooms overwhelmed, et cetera, et cetera. But what I was looking at was, I wanted to know, well, what about the rest of the year? So it's a little busy here, but what I did was I plotted all the deaths for all 365 days, and then rotated it, then reversed it around March 4th. And then, so it ran forwards and backwards. That's why you have this double peak on the left. The peak around the 60 is actually end of the year for in going reverse. But what this, so we have that the death rates are on the general curve around 21% higher in winter than in summer, 28% higher if you can include the year end. So what he also found was that the seasonality is observed for diseases of the circulatory system, the respiratory system, endocrine, nutritional, and metabolic diseases, and diseases of the digestive system, like bacterial infection. However, he observed no seasonality for cancer. I think the no seasonality for cancer is because it's just something, a disease that develops over a long period of time, whereas cardiovascular disease and respiratory infections and so on can happen rather quickly. Here is how the vitamin D levels vary throughout the year. And it turns out that the vitamin D level is minimum around the middle of February, and PTH is maximum around early March. And PTH can have an effect on health outcomes, as can vitamin D levels. And then they go reverse in summer. So it appears that UVB doses and vitamin D levels and PTH levels can affect the findings. But also, it's known that temperature, low temperature in winter and high temperature in summer, can be risk factors for disease and death. And then it turns out that UVA, the long-wave UV, can liberate nitric oxide from nitrogen stores under the skin, and that can lower blood pressure. So there are at least three factors at work here. We can't sort them all out, but we can say that it looks like they all play a role, and it's probably better to try to maintain summer conditions if you can. So how much, so if you, let's skip this. So we have, you've maybe heard about the UV index, which is often published in the paper, and if it's above a certain amount, you're supposed to put on sunscreen. Well, that's brought to you by our sunscreen manufacturers and dermatologists. For April 8th, United States, it would be a value of 6. 10 is high, back and down south, and 4, 1, 2 is low. Here's the annual variation for San Francisco for 2013. And it, I'm not sure if they've included clouds and fog in this, but so in winter, if it's green, it's hard to make vitamin D. If it's yellow, you can make some vitamin D. But when it gets in the above 8, you can make vitamin D fairly easily. If you're out in the summer, out in the sun, mainly during the noon hour, or from 10 to 2, 10 to 3, the higher the sun is in the sky, the more likely you are to make vitamin D, because if the sun's like at the horizon, most of the UVB is scattered out. I mean, the sky is blue because short waves scatter much more effectively than long waves. So the long waves, like the orange, come through and make the clouds orange and red, but the blue is scattered, and UVB is scattered even more. So if the sun's at 45, you're getting still a lot of UVA, but not so much UVB. And if it's below 30 degrees, you're not getting enough UVB to make vitamin D. There are some food sources of vitamin D. The average American gets about 300 international units of vitamin D per day from food, whether it be milk, fish, fortified orange juice, fortified cereals. Here's a cartoon. A guy's inside with a computer saying he's got fish and mushrooms for his source of vitamin D, but the sun is outside knocking and says, "Hey, you indoors, you need me for your vitamin D intake." There are two types of vitamin D supplements. One is called vitamin D3 or cholecalciferol. That's what we make in our skin. When you buy it in a pill form, it generally comes from sheep's wool lanolin that's been processed by UV exposure and chemical separation. Vitamin D2 is ergocalciferol. It's made from mushrooms or yeast. It's not as effective as D3. It doesn't last in the body as long. It doesn't even have as beneficial effects on health outcomes. But people who are vegans often want to stay away from animal products, and D3 is an animal product. The Institute of Medicine back in 2011 found only a benefit of vitamin D for bones. Now this committee was set up by the NIH and the FDA and Health Canada. I could tell the fix was in when they asked for nominations for people in various fields, and they had 17 areas of concern: cancer, cardiovascular, ethnic studies, et cetera, et cetera. And I nominated the best person in each one of those categories. They chose one, and it turns out he didn't even like vitamin D. So the FDA, they were out to show that vitamin D was very important. They said the only evidence they could use was from clinical trials, well-established clinical trials that had been published showing an effect. And by their criteria, they only found that vitamin D helped the bones. And to their credit, they did say, okay, you need 600 or 800 IU per day instead of 200 IU per day. But they wouldn't go higher. They said that they didn't see any adverse effects below 10,000 IU per day. And for point of reference, a person in the sun with a bathing suit on can make 10,000 IU per day. So that can't be hazardous if that's the physiological amount you can make. So they said, well, the upper limit that you should have not go above is 4,000 IU just for safety. Michael Hollick, who's sort of Mr. Vitamin D, led another study for the Endocrine Society and recommended levels reached 30 to 50 nanograms per milliliter for those with vitamin D deficiency. And he based this on clinical trials and observational studies. His recommendations were for people who had medical, who were under doctor's care. The Institute of Medicine, well, their recommendations were for the general public, but I mean, most people have a medical problem, so I think everybody should be dealing more with this. So they were recommending 1,500 to 2,000 IU per day for people with vitamin D deficiency. And they set the upper limit at 10,000 IU per day. Here's an example of how we've progressed over the last, we've came from the apes, I guess, went through the African plains, the dark skin, lost our hair, stood upright, developed pale skin as we came north, and now we're indoors and not getting much sun. So the old world primates have around 50 or 60 nanograms per milliliter levels. Humans exposed to vitamin D in Africa pretty much get around 45 to 50 nanograms. Normal in the, around here is more like 15 or 20 nanograms. We take 1,000 IU per day, it's more like 30 nanograms. And taking 4,000, you get up around 35 nanograms per milliliter. Turns out that you have a sort of a reservoir, and it takes a while to build up your vitamin D levels. And if this is looking at the top curve is for taking 10,000 IU per day, getting up to around 85 nanograms per milliliter. And it took around 4 months to get up to the maximum. So if you're planning to go to the hospital and have low vitamin D levels, you might take the 50,000 IU per day for several days, for a week or two, to sort of boost your levels rapidly, and then go back to 5,000 or so per day once you stabilize. So why is vitamin D not more widely accepted? Well, several reasons. One is the reluctance of the profit-making healthcare system in the U.S. to accept an idea that does not generate profits and reduces their income from treating disease. Here's a cartoon I found about how Big Pharma is fighting vitamin D. There's Komen for the Cure, the FDA, oncology, the National Cancer Institute, and Big Pharma, and the Federal Trade Commission. The Federal Trade Commission, for example, does not like people to advertise that UV lamps make vitamin D and vitamin D might have health benefits. So they all get them, they're all sort of in cahoots. And of course, we have the corporate press. Big Pharma is one of the biggest advertisers of corporate press, so it's really hard to get a story on vitamin D in the corporate press. So it's just hard to get the word out. The other problem is there are only a small number of successful randomized controlled trials. The FDA will only let you make a claim or of benefit if you have a clinical trial to prove it. Observational and ecological studies are considered subject to confounding factors. Some people claim that low vitamin D levels are due to illness, not the cause of illness. But this overlooks the fact that, UVB, maybe they just didn't have much UVB. There are several reasons for poor successful trials. One is a poor design, such as not measuring the vitamin D levels before enrolling people, or giving too little vitamin D. They can enroll people with adequate vitamin D levels who don't benefit, maybe too late in the progression of the condition or disease, and it might not reduce the risk of the health condition being studied. On the other hand, there are often more benefits of UV exposure than just the vitamin D production. And also, it's impossible to get vitamin D levels too high, since UV can also destroy vitamin D as well as create it. So people who are in the sun a long time, they'll be producing and destroying, and they have a stable level. So there are other effects found from UVB other than vitamin D production. Like I mentioned earlier, blood pressure can be lowered. There's a mouse model study in the Netherlands that showed that the mice who developed cancer, intestinal cancers, and had UV therapy and raised their vitamin D levels the same amount as those who took oral vitamin D had better survival, had fewer, less area and less volume of tumors than those just taking the oral vitamin D. They don't know the mechanism, but it appears that something has happened besides vitamin D production.
Is it hormonally active vitamin D3 type?
Is it the hormonally active vitamin D3 type they're giving them orally?
No, they gave them cholecalciferol, which is then converted to the 25 and the 125, but they measured the 25 hydroxy vitamin D, and it was the same in the both. They didn't measure the 125. Multiple sclerosis has UV effects other than vitamin D. I mentioned that nitric oxide production from UVA is also important for lowering blood pressure. The interesting thing about melanoma, this is a paper by the Garlands and Gorham, pointing out that as we've increased our use of sunscreen, sunblock, the rate of melanoma has gone up. And I mentioned earlier that there are ways the body protects against melanoma. One way is that just over centuries is that darker skin from people living where it's darker, they sort of select out those who have the darker skin will survive there, and the darker skin reduces the penetration of the UVA and UVB to the lower level of the skin where the melanocytes are, and that's where melanoma starts. So the tanning process, where if you go out in the spring and every day go a little bit more and get a little bit tanner, that also produces melanin, which blocks the UV penetration. Also, the outer layer of the skin called the stratum corneum gets thicker, and that blocks some of the UV penetration. Then there's also the vitamin D production. And vitamin D has been found to have ways to reduce both the development of melanoma and the progression of melanoma. Also, it turns out that people who have wrinkled skin, whether it comes from being in the sun or from smoking, have reduced risk of melanoma. Now, it's a robust finding. I reported it. I saw somebody who did it. I did my own ecological study report, or my own comparison of observational studies. And so the American Cancer Society decided they would check it in their own cohort. And they said, by God, people who smoke more get less melanoma. So it's been shown three different ways. We don't understand the mechanism. I thought it was maybe because the wrinkled skin was just make it difficult for the melanoma to reach out and spread. Just like if you're in a city with traffic, it's hard to travel, but if you're in a highway, you go fast. Nobody's buying that idea, but there's something going on. So anyway, the body has all these mechanisms for fighting melanoma. If you put on sunblock, sure, the problem is that the sunblock sold in the United States primarily blocks the UVB. It blocks a little bit of the erythema radiation, but it doesn't block the long-wave UV very well because the FDA will not approve the compounds in clear solutions that block the UVA for fear they might be chemicals that might be hazardous to your health internally. Never mind that Europe and Australia have been using these compounds for 10 years. Never mind that the Congress passed a law 2 years ago saying, get off your duff, FDA, and approve these compounds. So what happens if you wear the, it turns out this team, Garland and Gorham, showed that, looked at all the studies of sunscreen use in melanoma and found that if you wear sunscreen north of 40 degrees, you have an increased risk of getting melanoma. If you wear it south of 40 degrees, like the North Oregon-California border, you might have a reduced risk by reducing risk of sunburn. Okay, so talk about that, testing. The only way to know your vitamin D levels is have your 25-hydroxyvitamin D concentration measured. And you might want to test twice, once before you start taking supplements and once after you've supplemented to see if you're taking the right amount. There are some blood spot assays for around $60 or $70. You poke a hole in your finger, you draw some blood, you put it in some spots, you send it in the mail, it goes to one lab or another, and it's as accurate as the wet blood samples you would get in your doctor's office. Both grassrootshealth.net and vitamindcouncil.org sell these kits, and I've tested them. One time I tested, I got a 65, 67, and 69 nanogram per milliliter. So that was within 5% or 10%, which is as good as any vitamin D assay is these days. Skip over PubMed. VitaminDWiki.com is a very good source of information on vitamin D. Henry Lahore is a retired Boeing engineer who spends all his waking hours researching literature on vitamin D and making it accessible to the world on his website. Any open source paper that he gets, he'll put there, and he'll make it so he can translate to any of 90 languages. He'll make summaries of this and that. And it's a really source. One of my latest papers is featured there right now. Grassrootshealth.net, formed by Carol Baggerly around 2005. She was a successful retired businesswoman who calls herself a breast cancer treatment survivor. After she had mastectomy, she then learned about vitamin D, and she was just furious with the medical system that never told her about vitamin D. So she figured the medical system's never going to tell the public about vitamin D, so she formed grassrootshealth.net. And she's presenting information on vitamin D directly to the public and promoting the benefits of vitamin D for pregnant and nursing women. She's conducting studies wherever she gets funding and groups to do it in Arkansas and South Carolina and wherever else. Then there's the vitamindcouncil.org, founded by John Cannell. He has made several key findings that are reported this evening. I prepared a number of the summaries on various diseases that are given there, and they have a weekly newsletter. So you can get on their weekly newsletter and you get the latest findings on vitamin D, and you can write in questions to Dr. Cannell and he'll try to answer them. So here's a list of the resources. My own website is sunarc.org. There's the Vitamin D Society in Canada. And my email address is here. So that's the formal presentation.
Okay, any questions?
Hi there. Are there any other supplements or minerals that you can take in conjunction with vitamin D that might maximize like the absorption?
Well, there's some that you might want to take in conjunction with vitamin D. John Cannell developed a product called D3+, which has vitamin K2, calcium, and magnesium. We often get too little magnesium in all of our food and supplements, and the K2 helps with the bone buildup and with fighting cancer. So, and magnesium helps counterbalance calcium. So it's a good, you can buy those separately, but those are the ones you want to consider taking. Maybe omega-3 fatty acid as well, although not too much. Yes?
Would you say again how you view the risk of eating meat that's not been roasted or fried?
I don't quite.
If you don't roast your meat or fry it, what's the risk?
Okay. If you eat raw meat, you have a risk of E. coli or salmonella or something like that in the United States. I mean, in Germany, they sold Hackepeter, which is just raw beef, I guess, and it seemed to be okay. But of course, you eat sushi. Sushi's raw, and people seem to eat that without too much problem. And it has much lower these advanced glycation end products. So it's how much you trust your source of the meat.
I had a dermatologist tell me it was better to take supplements than get out in the sun, risk skin cancer.
Well, I'm working with Mark Sorensen on a book on sunshine and vitamin D. And we've got three stories of people who spent much of their childhood in the sun and are in the 60s, 70s, or 70s and 80s now with no skin cancer, no internal cancers. I grew up in Sacramento, got sunburn and suntan every year. Mark grew up on a farm in Nevada, got sunburn there and suntan every year. Got a friend, an engineer about 80 years old in Virginia, who he was a lifeguard, went out every summer, no umbrella, no sunscreen. No melanoma. His wife died of ovarian cancer, which is vitamin D sensitive. His brother, who's red hair and freckles, stayed out of the sun and has melanoma and internal cancers. So, and I showed you the curve, how melanoma rates have been increasing in time, even though dermatologists are telling us stay out of the sun. The dermatologists, in fact, it's interesting, in Australia, the dermatologists so much believe their idea about wearing hats, sunblock, and long sleeves and so on, that their vitamin D levels are lower than African Americans in the United States. The dermatologists just are not, they see the vitamin D story as competing with their story about UV as a hazard for skin cancer melanoma. Now, admittedly, skin cancer, basal cell carcinoma, is probably the most common cancer in the United States. But that's like you have a drive a car, you have an accident, you hit the bumper, you paint it. You've saved the engine and the passengers. And I think that's the thing about UV exposure and getting your vitamin D the natural way, which has other benefits. And if you do it properly, is not a risk factor for melanoma and skin cancer. But in their simple way, I mean, too often the doctors and the medical system have very simple rules. Like back in 1978, it was eat less fat. What happened? America became obese. They didn't realize there are different types of fat, trans fatty acids, omega-3, omega-6, saturated, et cetera, et cetera. And then they say, well, don't eat carbohydrates. Well, they're complex carbohydrates and simple carbohydrates. So it's a very complex message, and I don't think the dermatologists want to get in a complex message.
Well, what was the other source? You had two sources for the blood test?
So it's Grassroots Health and Vitamin D Council.
You talked about vitamin D in pregnancy. What evidence is there about vitamin D and fertility?
There's some studies on artificial in vitro fertilization that there's some benefits there. There's also a study I like from France showing that men have the roundest sperm in August. It's also that test, there's been a randomized controlled trial study of obese men in Australia. Found that giving them vitamin D increased their testosterone levels. In fact, my levels were off the chart until I lowered my 25-hydroxy vitamin D by 10%, and testosterone came down by 10%. I think you'll find that the animals, I think they have seasonal cycles when they get pregnant, and I'm not sure whether that's related to vitamin D, but it's certainly related to when the food is most available.
Do you have a suggestion on time of day taking the vitamin D, taking more than once per day, or that sort of
well,
thing?
Well, okay. Vitamin D stays in the body around, the 25-hydroxy vitamin D has a half-life of 2 to 4 or 6 weeks. If you have high vitamin D levels, high 25-hydroxy levels, it's going to be a shorter lifetime than if you have lower levels. But, so you can actually take vitamin D daily, weekly, biweekly. But the one recommendation is to take it with the largest meal of the day. Because then it's going to slow the digestion process, keep it in your system longer, in your tract longer for absorption. And the biotech sells a water-soluble version, and even they put vitamin D in orange juice, which doesn't have any fat, but the fat in your body will take care of linking to it.
Are you losing the benefit of certain light rays by wearing sunglasses? Is that...
Some people think so, yeah. As you get older, you have a risk of cataracts from the UV. I'm not sure whether it's UVB or UVA, but there's, of course, the effect on the blue light coming in is what can help reset your circadian rhythm. When I flew for NASA and went to Norway for 2 weeks in February, I could not get on their time zone in the 2 weeks because there wasn't enough bright blue light. I could go from San Francisco to Moscow in the summer, and one day I'm in Moscow time. So there is that benefit of affecting the wake-sleep cycle and the body rhythm. So that's an important benefit.
I'm going to just add a brief comment. I've experimented with vitamin D in a variety of ways, and one of the things that I've noted is that if I take vitamin D at 50,000 unit doses, I have to take it in the morning not to have circadian consequences. Huh. I'll have either shallow sleep or insomnia if I take it at the end of the day in that kind of a dose.
I'd like to add to that. When I've taken very high doses of vitamin D, which I did when I had Lyme disease that was prevalent, I found that it could actually create an almost seizure-like effect in my brain if I had too much of it at one time, which I thought was amazing. And quite recently, I had a gynecologist doctor who scolded me severely for having high levels of vitamin D25 hydroxy, that I was taking way too much vitamin D. He was so incensed about it, he actually wrote a very nasty letter so that it would be in my records of his files.
Anyway. You'll probably outlive him.
Yeah, I might. I wanted to ask you to please speak a little bit to, I apologize for my confusion here. May I just say where I'm confused and then you can straighten me out. So the body takes in sun, UVB, makes vitamin D, it converts, and at some point it becomes hormonally effective. Is that a quantity or a type? And how is that related to vitamin D3 that we take in supplements?
Okay, well, one of the earlier slides. So you take oral vitamin D or make it in the skin, it goes to the liver and gets 1-hydroxyl, becomes 25-hydroxy vitamin D. Then it goes to the kidneys, can go to the kidneys where it receives another one, and so the circulating the hormonal version is made in the kidneys. But if you have breast cancer or ovarian cancer or something else, those organs can also make 125. So the organs that need it will make it when they need it. It's sort of like the building material is sort of flowing around, and if the organ or the body needs it, it will make it from the substrate.
Then please explain the genetic aspect of that.
Okay, then you have vitamin D receptors that take this hormonal version that comes in like the key that unlocks it.
125D.
Right. And this then is linked to the chromosomes, and some of the genes are affected by it, maybe 10% of the body's genes.
And then the last part of that would be then, if you have telomerase decline, would this help to augment, along with maybe taking telomeres or something to augment that, to be able to reverse aging to some degree?
There have been
studies. And keep genes that are being made, new genes being made more accurately?
There are studies showing that both 25-hydroxy vitamin D is directly correlated with telomere length, and I think there may even be some studies showing that taking vitamin D can lengthen them again. I'd have to look up that, but at least there's correlation between the 25-hydroxy vitamin D and the length.
Okay, let's give a round of applause for Bill. We have to break.